好，我哋開始會議。
Good afternoon, members. Let's start the meeting. Item 1 on the agenda. Information paper issued since the last meeting. We do have one. CB bracket 2, 825/16-17/01. A referral from the Public Complaints Office on policy issues relating to protection to new arrivals from the mainland against discrimination. We have already issued the paper to members. Please note the referral. Well, I think this will be covered by one of the items to be discussed at our next meeting, namely the discrimination law review by the Equal Opportunities Commission. At this moment, please invite the public officers to join us. Item 2, items for discussion at the next meeting. I'd like to welcome Mr. Ronald Chen, Undersecretary for Constitutional Mainland Affairs, as well as Mr. Wong Sim Man and their respective teams. For the agenda at our next meeting, please take a look at paper CB bracket 2, 828/16-17/01, where we have the list of outstanding items for discussion. Mr. Ronald Chen, Undersecretary, please brief us on the two proposed items. Thank you. We would like to have a discussion of the following two items. First of all, initial assessment of the recommendations in the discrimination law review submitted by the EOC. The scope is quite wide-ranging. So, for the priorities suggested by the EOC, we would like to have a discussion of the CA panel. We also hope that we would like to cover those that can be easily agreed upon to be discussed first. Say, for example, banning the discrimination against breastfeeding mother, and we want to expand the scope of anti-discrimination laws. The recommendations will cover all the four pieces of anti-discrimination law that we have got. The second item is a progress report from the Privacy Commissioner for Personal Data for the year 2016. So we suggest that we invite the Commissioner to give you a report at your next meeting. Mr. Chen, we have received a referral from the Public Complaints Office on policy issues relating to protection to new arrivals from mainland against discrimination. So it's a matter of discrimination on the status of their citizenship. I would like to cover this under the EOC item as well. Please note our proposal. Dr. Helena Wong. Thank you, Chair. The CE election is underway. The liaison office, as well as officials from the CPG, are seen to be playing a very active role in the nomination procedures. They approached the election committee members, and Sik Chong, a former CE, publicly said that even if John Chang is elected, he will not be appointed by the CPG. I want to know whether it is an offense to do so for the liaison office and for a former CE to play such roles in the electoral process. I want to know whether it is an offense. Is it possible for us to arrange for a meeting in the short term just to clarify the role to be played by the liaison office? Mr. Chen, our position has always been that we don't comment on speculative reports in the media. No, I'm not speculating. Let him finish first. He talked about speculative reports. Let him finish first. All the time, we've been emphasizing that our elections will be conducted in strict adherence with the existing laws. If there is a complaint to be lodged with the EAC, we will act accordingly. If necessary, it will be referred to the relevant law enforcement agencies. Now, Mr. Sichtung made a public comment. It's not my speculation, and you can't speculate that I was speculating. For such acts, for such conducts, I think we are owed an official position. Now you're saying that we need to lodge a complaint with the DAC and then you will act on it. So what are you doing here? We say that perhaps it is an offense. So we want to get an explanation from the administration. So Mr. Chairman, perhaps we can have it included under AOB. I'm not sure whether this can be discussed before the March 26th CE election. If not, then probably we need a special meeting. Now, during the nomination period and in future at the election, we want to know about the comments made by the liaison office as well as the former CE. I want to know about the status of such comments. I do intend to have it included under AOB. But then for your proposal to have a meeting as quickly as possible to discuss the matter, I want to consult members. Members, what do you think? Mr. Lam Chak Ting. Mr. Chairman, I support Helena's proposal. Now the CE election is a very important election. Currently, we have got a lot of information to show that liaison office officials and even a former CE have done certain things that would affect the fairness of the election, and I wonder whether they are interfering with the CE election in Hong Kong. So there is a urgency to hold a meeting ASAP. Well, in fact, I've been given to understand that an oral question or a question has been put in to cover this matter. A question is different from a meeting of the CAP. If we can have a discussion at a meeting of the CAP, it will be all the more better. Mr. Leung Chi Chang, I agree with what Mr. Chen has said. That is, Helena was merely referring to some speculative comments in the papers. Did she hear the comments made by Sichtung himself? If she did, and if she thinks that it is an offense, then she has to report on him rather than having it discussed here. This is about the electoral laws in Hong Kong. If you have no faith in the CE election-related laws, it is quite meaningless. Now, we'll talk about review of electoral affairs. Now, if we start to consider individual cases, it's not right because there's no urgency. If you really think so, all you have to do is to report the matter. It's not right for us to start accusing others. If it is an urgent matter, maybe we can put in an oral question that can expedite things. I don't think we should be talking something which may breach the electoral laws on our part. Fernando Zhang, thank you, Chair. Yes, we are preparing for the CE election. It is a very important matter for us. We have to ensure that the CE election is fair, and we have read many media reports.
Even our LegCo colleagues, different colleagues, have expressed that they were influenced by the, they were contacted by the former senior officials, former CE and officials of the liaison office, and they seem to have interfered with the fairness of the election. The question is whether this is the suitable venue to discuss this issue, and what suitable response should be made. The Legislative Council panel on constitutional affairs should be concerned about the political system in Hong Kong and also the election in particular. The Electoral Commission should make the suitable administrative arrangement, and we have the CMAB to watch over the whole electoral system. Ms. Selina Wong's proposal is worth our attention, and some members may raise their questions at the LegCo meeting. The LegCo is the suitable venue to express its concern towards the election. The question is whether we agree or whether the chairman believes that there is an urgency to embark on a discussion of this matter. I personally think that there is. Yes. Yes, can you be precise and brief? I don't want to spend too much time on this item, and other members want to speak as well. Basically, I support Ms. Lina Wong's proposal. Does any other member wish to speak? Oh, draw a line there. Claudia Mo, Wong Ting Kong, Yip Kin Yun, Priscilla Leung, and Chao Ho Ting, the Vice Chairman. And Kwang Chun Yu. Why do you raise your hand? Ms. Chiang, do you want to speak? Well, after Mr. Kwang. I speak after Mr. Kwang. Okay, you speak after Mr. Kwang then. I'll draw a line there. This is just a discussion on the items to be discussed at the next meeting. I don't want to spend too much time on that, and I hope the members can be brief and precise in their speech. Ms. Claudia Mo. Thank you, Chairman. Well, I didn't intend to speak, and I didn't want to waste time on this. But the official's answer was that Ms. Selina Wong was just referring to speculative reports. That was irresponsible. I give you the information, and it's not appropriate for me to disclose the source of information. I can give you evidence on how the interference was made. You cannot just say that it is speculative and you just wad off the proposal. Chairman, I know that you will not entertain the request, but if you can ask your conscience concerning election, it's not just as important as the election of the CE, just the election of the chairman. And the former chairman of the political party said that he supported a certain candidate. You have the influence, and that is unfair if you express your express your view. Now you say that the central government has the power to decide, and it can refuse to appoint. That is constitutional crisis. Chairman, you're more familiar with this than myself. It's a waste of breath if we discuss it here, but I hope that the officials in answering the question will just ward off the question and just said that it's all okay. It is all in well. Mr. Wong Ting Kwong. Chairman, I just want the chairman to tell me whether newspaper reports, media reports, should be discussed if a member asks for doing so. Media reports, number one. Number two, now a member says that she understands the situation very well and she's not able to disclose information in public, and she can privately provide information to a certain party. So should she deal with it privately? In this open meeting, she wants to give the information to his own party privately. Is it appropriate? If I agree, then would I be a rubber stamp?
現在選緊係中華人民共和國。
Now this is a grand jury concession. We're electing the CE of the SARG of the PRC. According to media report, even if Mr. Tong has given a view, is Mr. Tong one of the people of Hong Kong? And doesn't he have the right to express his view? You champion freedom of expression. Shouldn't you also consider the freedom of expression of other people? I have to draw a line. I'll give you each member 1 minute because of time constraint. Ms. Sip Kin Yuen, how many minutes? 1 minute. 1 minute, suddenly. Chairman, on this issue is not speculative. Among members of this council, some have already said very clearly that he or she was suffering from enormous pressure, and we cannot avoid this issue. It is a serious issue. The central government has a power to appoint a CE, and that is a substantive power. In the election process, the intervention by the liaison office or the influence, according to the report by Mr. C.H. Tong, he quoted the instruction from the central government that he is influencing the election. The credibility of the election is undermined. The relationship of the central government and Hong Kong is undermined. This is a very important issue, and the panel cannot dodge this. I support Ms. Lina Wong's proposal. Thanks, Ms. Priscilla Lam. The vice chairman. Chairman. Just now, Ms. Wong said, Mr. Tong said something. According to my understanding, that was only a citation by the media, and that citation has not been confirmed. Now, that is hearsay. Now, in the legal sector, we often say this is hearsay evidence. In short, this panel deal with that. If there is any breach of the law in the election process, then it should be dealt with by the Electoral Commission. It is not to be dealt with by this panel. And one should not raise a certain issue simply because of hearsay, because you don't know the truth of the matter, and we shouldn't take the place of another authority to deal with that, Mr. Kwong. Now, if it is not established, it's not appropriate for you to discuss that. If it has been established, then you go to report to the police. And then the panel has nothing to do. Ms. Lina Wong's proposal is a very important issue, is a concern of the public. I also have submitted a question for the coming LegCo meeting. If you're not going to say it today, discuss it today, you still have to say something on it in the future. And now, concerning no appointment by the central government, there's a kind of threat. In fact, it's scary. And this council should take people's concern to its heart. If it is hearsay, we are not going to discuss it. If it has been established, then we are not going to discuss it. That's nonsense. The Ms. Chang, news is new every day. And when you have heard something new, and when you have some doubts about it, then they will come to you, Chairman. We have to call a special meeting to discuss the matter. Then you'll be very busy. Recently, I heard that a certain candidate a certain problem with his or her private life, then should I raise it with you? That's about the person's privacy, and we have to dispose it and let the public know about it. I've just heard from Ms. Claudia Mo that she has a certain source of information, but she doesn't want to tell us. I think you have a dementia problem recently. Now, we've just heard something outside, and then we raise it here, then it is really not appropriate and is not fair to the parties concerned. Well, if you have any view, then you should complain to the REO or EC. All right, having heard members' comments, I have no intention to deal with the issue for the time being. I'll wait after Wednesday, after Mr. Kwong has raised his question, and if members feel that there's a need to follow the matter up, please write in to me. Okay, next item on the agenda, and that is item 3 on the list, the review of objection mechanism in relation to the voter registration system. Mr. Ronald Chan, would you please introduce the government's paper? Thank you, Chairman. Excuse me. In response to the concerns expressed by the public in the 2015 VR cycle, the government embarked on a review on the existing VR system and rent arrangement and conducted public consultation on enhancement of the system and issued a report in 2015. In the review, concerning the large number of objection cases, and the revising officer has to deal with such cases within a short period of time. Some of the view that the government should formulate measures to prevent the abuse of the objection mechanism and also reduce the inconvenience caused to voters because of the requirement to attend the hearing. Now, having consulted, having completed consultation, the objector should have would have the right, would have the duty to attend, and also that is the power to deal with indubitable cases. We studied the cases of the practice of UK, Australia, New Zealand, and Canada. Details are in the paper for members' reference. With regard to improving the objection mechanism, we have considered the following issues. First, we have to consider the provisions in the law in respect of requiring the one who raised the objection will have to justify his case. Now, even if the objector is not required to provide evidence beyond reasonable doubt, the objector still has the responsibility to provide adequate information and full justification to substantiate the claim or the objection. The second point of consideration is whether the objector is required to attend the hearing. And we have to consider whether this is proportionate and whether this will deter the public from voicing objections, and will the attendance affect the justification of the case. Now, if the objector doesn't attend the hearing, then the revising officer may dismiss the case. I emphasize the word may. It is may, but not should. And whether the objector should attend the hearing depends on the nature of the case, and it's up to the revising officer to decide such a requirement. And if adequate evidence has been produced, say for example, the address of a certain voter has disappeared, is no longer in existence, or the building has been demolished, then whether the objector attends the hearing or not will not affect the justification of the case, and there is no definite requirement for the objector to attend the hearing. The third is empowering the REO to process indubitable objection cases. Our proposal is that the law can provide that the REO can assess whether it is frivolous or vexatious or it is a typographical error. On such cases, the REO can deal with this in writing and seek the approval of the revising officer. According to the decision of the revising officer, the REO can retain, delete, or revise the relevant item. This is to simplify procedure without causing inconvenience to the objector and also minimize the burden on the revising officer.
We also need to consider we have to extend the time limit for processing and hearing objection and claim cases. After careful consideration, we believe that such a proposal will unavoidably advance the deadlines for voter registration. In other words, this would widen the time gap between the deadline for registration and the election day, and this may also discourage eligible persons from getting registered. And we have to consider the implications, in particular the updatedness of the particulars. If we are to improve the mechanism according to the directions that I have referred to, in theory, the number of cases requiring hearing arising from claims or objections, probably the number will reduce. So there's no strong justification to extend the time limit for processing and hearing objection and claim cases. I would like to pause here, and myself and my colleagues will be happy to listen to your views, and we are happy to answer your questions. Thank you. Thank you. 4 minutes each for questions and answers, starting with Claudia Mo. Thank you, Chair. Well, we had the suspicion that there was vote rigging. Well, it's common to have one household with three surnames if you have a grandmother. But if you've got four surnames, if you've got a relative or a tenant, then that's fine. I've visited certain subdivided units in Tokwa 1. Indeed, they have six households, and that's why they have six different surnames at the same address. Now, I think it's a matter of producing the evidence. If I suspect that there is a case of irregularity, then I invite you to carry out an investigation. I don't think it is satisfactory if you don't investigate into the matter, even though I have reasonable ground to suspect. But of course, if there are to be indiscriminate objections, whenever we have got three different surnames in the same household, then it will not again be right. Now, of course, those who are being suspected will get angry. Say, for example, if it is said that there are four surnames in the household. What is even worse is that I need to take a day off, approach the EAC or the REO, and then attend a hearing. Now, you have said that it depends on the circumstances as to whether a hearing will be needed, or can I verbally confirm with you why we have got four or five different surnames in the household? Would a letter of explanation suffice? Mr. Chen. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Mo referred to the scenario of one household having a few surnames. The REO has carried out verification, and we have also got the statutory inquiry process. The verification work itself covers multiple surname households. Therefore, when it comes to the VR process for multiple surname households, we have already got the gatekeeping function. And that takes us to another step. That is, once the provisional register has been published, members of the public may want to raise objection in the light of the details in the provisional register. Now, our question is, on what basis can a member of the public be allowed to raise an objection? Now, having listened to the feedback, it is said that if the objection is based on guesstimate or suspicion or malicious, it could be a malicious one because they want to make life difficult for you. Now, if the objector does not have hard evidence or the objector hasn't got reasonable ground to suspect, we believe that in such cases, the objector is not justified. Therefore, we're saying that in the law, we have to make it clear. Of course, we aren't saying that the objector has to prove his case beyond reasonable doubt. Rather, in the objection, the objector must provide sufficient grounds so that we have reason to believe that it is a justifiable objection, and then he can raise the objection. We believe that this is better. Next, Priscilla Leung. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For the administration, I've always been asking this question. That is, you have been carrying out random checking in relation to elderly voters. You want to check whether their addresses are correct. I want to know how many people have lost their voter status as a result. Now, all of us across the political spectrum have been criticizing you because the inquiry letter is in fine print. Elderly people can't read them. How many of them have passed away, and so, and also how many have failed to answer, and so they've lost the status? And then what about the right to vote and the right to be elected? I think you have been muttering through it ever since the so-called vote rigging suspicion. Now, people cannot afford the expensive rent in Hong Kong, so they have moved to the mainland to live, but they come back to work. We have asked for clarification as to whether such people can vote. I want to know how many people have lost their elector status. Maybe they don't want to come back to vote, or they have listened to your advice, they have retired to the mainland, but then they have lost their status as a voter. Do you have the figures? And then some members have lamented that is their mothers are getting old, and then they would like to cancel the voter registration. I've advised against that. You need to respect the elders' right to vote, and within the same household, there may be different incarnations. Well, sometimes it is said that grandchildren are asking their grandparents to abolish the voter registration, or some have been asking the elders to vote in accordance with the younger generation's preference. So have you done anything to safeguard their freedom to make a choice in the ballot box? I'd like to defer to the REO. Yes, let me talk about the question of random checking. For the 2016 VR cycle, as a result of the random checking, there were about 11,000 electors who have their names deleted from the register. As to electors who have passed away, the figure is rather stable, between 20 and 30,000. For citizens who have moved to the mainland, and as a result, their names being struck from the register, we haven't got such a detailed breakdown. We have got different reasons for checking. Well, do you have figures to show that some people are so poor then they have to go to Shenzhen to live or they work in Shenzhen? So, and some other elders have also retired. Please give a more succinct answer. Well, it won't be as simple as that. There is somebody relocated himself to Shenzhen and so he lose his eligibility because we have this requirement of being an ordinary resident. You go to Shenzhen, but it doesn't mean that it is an automatic loss of status. Well, people dare not come back to vote. How can they maintain their eligibility? Mr. Lam checked in. Mr. Chairman, prior to the last district council election, I personally lodged an objection or a complaint. In most cases, the complaints have been justified and then the electors have to amend their addresses or the electors have the name removed from the register. I recall that when I filled out the objection forms, I was asked to give clearly the ground of objection. Say, for example, I visited the address, there wasn't such an address, or it was an industrial or commercial address, and nobody is supposed to live there. In other words, I have been able to raise a reasonable suspicion. Now, you're saying that the onus of proof is on the objector. It's scary. Does it mean that we're turned into prosecutors? For somebody who's just a lay person, is it fair? We haven't got the power to investigate, to collect evidence, we haven't got the manpower, and we haven't got sufficient time to verify the registration particulars. This is because even for a district council constituency, we may have 6,000 or 7,000 electors. We're talking about a huge number of addresses to see if somebody is really engaged in vote rigging. It will cost us a lot of money and time. Just now, the Undersecretary was saying that extending the time limit would not be advisable. I don't think it's reasonable. The way I see it is that you have only got 25 days, and yet we have to cover so much. Now, I'm not asking you to extend it by a few months. Can it not be extended by 3 more weeks so that we have 40, 50 days so that the candidates can verify the information? Then it will mean that we don't have to live according to such a tight schedule. Now, if people have been waiting for 2 or 3 years before they get registered, now you say that by having a few more weeks for us to verify the addresses, this will deter the electors from getting registered. Now, if I knock on the door a few times, no one comes to answer the door, and then the letterbox has been filled with dust and nobody has attended to it at all, then isn't it not reasonable suspicion? If you demand reasonable suspicion, fine, but what about onus of proof? That's going too far. Mr. Chen, we are now saying that we would like to prescribe in the law that the objector has the duty to provide sufficient information and come up with sufficient ground of objection to justify his case. I think basically that's what we want. But this is already being provided for in the objection form. Yes, Mr. Lam, you're right. We do have this box to ask the objector to give the ground of objection. But currently, the law doesn't make it clear that this is a duty of the objector. We are not so clear about the onus of proof. We have only been relying on the general principles of our laws, and then we expect the objector to come up with a justification. In the past, when the objections were dealt with, does it mean that it will suffice if I've given a ground of my objection? I'm simply saying that in the past, the revising officers have also said that the objector should provide a ground of objection instead of just purely relying on speculation.
Mr. Yip Kin-yuen, Chairman. Just now, the question raised by Mr. Lam is a good question concerning the onus of proof. It's very demanding on the objector. Now it says that the objector, but someone who are concerned about the election provides a certain information to assist the authorities to identify problematic registrations. If he can prove that it is problematic, if he has the onus of proof, then how many people can do that? I have great doubt about it. There's a need to find a suitable balance. We should try the best to prevent people abusing the objection mechanism, yet there shouldn't be any abuse of the electoral system. So if there is reasonable doubt, then that reasonable doubts can be raised, and that will be suffice. That will be adequate to deal with the abuse. As for simplifying the procedures, this is reasonable. We don't want to burden the REO or the court with too much workload, but we should also find a suitable balance to prevent abuse of the electoral system. Now, in paragraph 7, I have the following question. Now, there is a table showing the number of claims and objections. Now, it purports to tell us the situation of abuse, but it doesn't tell us how many successful objections are there, leading to the striking out of certain registrations. How many such cases are there? I think we need these numbers to assess whether there is abuse and to what extent is abuse. So the election officers or the undersecretary, let me respond to the first part of the question by Mr. Yip, and then I ask the electoral officers to answer the question. I agree with Mr. Yip that we should find a suitable balance, and that is because of this that we conducted a public consultation in 2015 as to whether we should improve the objection mechanism and how should we go about it. According to the views collected, many of the view that the objector in voicing the objection should provide justification, adequate justification. The revising officer in handling cases in the past that clearly expressed the view that the objector in voicing objection should provide the grounds instead of just voicing objection basing on speculations. Basing on these reasons, we made our proposal. The Chairman, yes, justification is our grounds are adequate, but the onus of proof is too high. Ms. Helena Wong, Chairman. I want to refer to 9A and B. The objector, the burden of proof rests on the objectors, and the objector be required to appear at the hearings. The Democratic Party opposes this proposal. I agree that the objectors provide the grounds for objection. If you put burden of proof on the objector, that is not appropriate. You require the objector to provide the grounds, but You do not specify the responsibility of the REO. If you don't specify that, it seems that the objectors will have to adduce adequate evidence. Say, for example, if someone has raised the point that there is vote stuffing in respect of a certain address in a private building, and he has provided the information, but he is unable to provide adequate evidence. But the REO should conduct an investigation on that. As for the second bit, required to appear at the hearings, this is different from the current practice. The objector may not be required to attend the hearing. And if the objector is unable to attend the hearing, the objector can still specify the grounds of objection in writing. You also mentioned the requirement in UK and Canada that the objector must attend the hearing. The objector can attend and authorize somebody to represent him or her or make a written submission. That is in line with the current practice, and this is reasonable. Otherwise, you put too much burden on the objector. You discourage the objector, ask the objector not to do anything. Well, if I'm a teacher, I have to attend your hearing. I will have to stay away from the classes. That is too much. We oppose the requirement to attend a hearing. Now, as for B, empower the REO to process indubitable objection cases. But what do we mean by indubitable objection cases? In dealing with such cases, shouldn't the REO specify the reasons for rejecting the objection? The Under Secretary, Chairman, let me clarify the following point. Ms. Wong referred to paragraph 9, where there are two proposals. That was the recommendation, or that were, those were the recommendations in the report upon the after the consultation, and that these recommendations pointed out the direction. Now, after that, we also said that we take a leave from overseas practice, and we looked into specific cases. As for giving the grounds, I hope that Ms. Wong will refer to paragraph 14 of our paper. That paragraph reflects our proposal very clearly. Now, we say that while the objector or claimant is not required to prove beyond doubt of the objection or claim, it should be set out in the law that he or she has the responsibility to provide sufficient information and grounds to substantiate his or her cases. Now, that is the direction we want to go along. Yes, can you be precise? I've already said that we do not require all the objectors to attend the hearing. It is upon it depends on the nature of the case and also the grounds of objection. Then the revising officer will consider that, and if adequate grounds have been provided, then the objector may not be required to attend the hearing. If information or grounds are not sufficient, then the objector may be required to attend the hearing, and if the objector doesn't attend, then the revising officer may strike out the objection. Mr. Yang is not here. Mr. Christopher Chong, not here. Mr. Leung Chi Chang. Thank you, Chairman. As for the so-called objection mechanism, quote-unquote, the problem is that if somebody objects, then a hearing will be held. Then the voter who is at the other end of the objection will have to attend the hearing. He has to go to the court. I think the government should be more stringent in dealing with that. Otherwise, the case will be abused. Well, my son was the subject of the objection, and I thought that I could represent him, but that was not allowed. He had to go to work, and he would not quit. He would not lose his job simply. He would not lose his job simply because of the registration as a voter. Now, the person who is at the other end of the objection will have to prove that he is I think it's difficult to give evidence. You have to prove that you live there. It is hard to do so. Even if you show letters, the revising officer does not accept. I really don't understand this. I don't know why it's so hard to prove. I think it's reasonable for the objector to provide the evidence. If registration is very complicated, there is no point of registering, and there is no point of going about doing the voting. So you encourage people to register as voter. You also encourage people to object. That's problematic. Now, in the new territories, there are many villages, and the villagers do not have easy access to receiving the letters posted to them. So they just rely on the village store at the and they go to the village store to collect their mail. Now the REO send letters to these addresses, and if the villagers do not go there to collect the mail, then their voters' registration will be struck out. Not only elderly people, but middle-aged people also have lost their voting rights because of this. Is there any mechanism to rectify the situation? Thank you, Chairman. Now, to provide integrity and credibility and fairness of the voter registration system, the checking and inquiry system is necessary. We have heard that these inquiry or checking arrangements will affect the rights of the voters. Because of this, we have introduced supplementary measures. Say, for example, the inquiry letters. In the past, they were posted by registered mail, and now we have changed the law to allow ordinary mail so that people can receive it more easily. We also allow voters to update their information. They can provide us with their email address and mobile phone numbers. And the REO attempts to contact voters through all channels. If we have mobile phone numbers and email addresses of voters, then we can contact them through these means rather than just by ordinary mail. And if they do not receive such information or such inquiries, then they can liaise with the REO. Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Chan. The Vice Chairman. Chairman, we look into this topic, and that is review of objection mechanism. That is because Mr. Wen, in 2015, was alleged to have abused the system. He raised large numbers of objections, and quite a large quantity had been withdrawn, and many people suffered because they were called to the hearing and there were complaints.
反對登記。
I think we should review this mechanism because it is susceptible to abuse. I read the paper. First of all, in the case of the UK government has certain requirements of the objector. That is, the objector must live in the same constituency as the person being objected to. We should also make reference to the UK practice, that is, the relevant electoral official can deal with the objection if it is found that it cannot be pursued at all and no hearing would be needed. It is only when there is really a case, there is a reasonable ground, then a hearing will be held. I think in this way we can prevent the possibility of abuse or mismatching of the resources. And just now, we have talked about whether the objector should be made to attend the hearings themselves. I think, to me, the objector must attend the hearing. As to whether he must, of course, it's up to us to consider. But then if the objector won't attend the hearing, then I think the revising officer can cite this as the ground to handle the case. Now, one single person may raise many objections. If he doesn't attend the hearing, but then each and every citizen being objected to has to attend the hearings, it will be most unfair to the innocent electors. Please consider. Any reply? No? Then next, Professor Yu. In relation to paragraph 14 of the paper, we get the proposal from the administration. The complexity is who is to determine that there is sufficient information and there is sufficient ground? I think we need an enforcing agency. Upon receipt of superficial information, then there should be a decision as to whether there is sufficient information and sufficient ground. In this way, we can dispense with the unreasonable complaints, and then we don't have to ask the laypersons to take up the responsibility to gather evidence. Mr. Chen, for Professor Yu's proposal, I think this is reflected in our recommendation. First of all, when the REO receives a case and provided our proposals are adopted, then the REO will be given the authority to screen the objections. Say, for example, screening out the clerical errors or other cases which are obviously frivolous or vexatious. So in this way, the REO can screen out such cases. But of course, after that, a written submission is needed to tell the revising officer how the case has been handled, and then we can conclude the case. For the other cases, all of them have to be handled by the revising officer. Well, just now, many of members talked about the onus of proof. So can the REO be given the task to adduce evidence so that the objector doesn't have to be bothered with that, and then it will be a win-win-win situation? Mr. Chairman, the current mechanism works in such a way that the REO, if time and circumstances permit, may get as much information as possible. Say, for example, liaising with the electors being objected to, and in the course of the matter, provide assistance to the revising officer in clarifying the position and come up with the appropriate ruling. In future, in the law, we'll also make it clear that it is hoped that the objector will come up with the grounds of objection. I think in this way, it will also help the REO in getting more information to assist the revising officer in coming to a decision. So, the existing mechanism and the future improvements will mean that the REO does have a role to play. I think you need to amend the law to say that the REO is responsible for confirming whether the objector has given sufficient information and grounds. The onus of proof should lie with the REO. So write clearly that the onus of proof rests with the executive department rather than the citizens. And then the revising officer will judge on the case. So there will be a clear division of labor. Otherwise, according to paragraph 9, if the citizens have to bear the onus of proof, then I'm afraid it is unfair. Well, for the complainant to adduce evidence and bears the onus of proof, I'm afraid this is the perpetual principles in the law courts. But of course, the so-called onus of proof means abusing sufficient evidence. You say that this is the general rule? The accused will have the onus of proof. I think you can consult your colleagues in the civic party. Mr. Riley, for the discussion of this paper, Mr. Chen, please understand a few characteristics of our culture. Honest people, particularly those from the grassroots and the elderly people, they are put off by the idea of going to a tribunal or to a court. This is a fact. If they receive a letter asking them to go to a hearing so as to defend himself, so as to keep his voter registration status, it will be too much pressure for them. So I agree with the spirit of the paper, that is, if somebody is challenged, he can choose to be represented and he doesn't have to attend the hearing in person. Now, the deputy chair has said that there was abuse last time, and the person abusing the mechanism was one of the candidates, and he might have political motives. Because somebody can lodge numerous complaints, and then, as I have said, people don't want to deal with such cumbersome procedures merely for the sake of voter registration, then those being objected will easily lose their status as electors. So other than asking the objector to come up with a reasonable suspicion, and I think it is fair, say for example, if we can prove that there is abuse or there is a political motive, do we have a penalty for that? It is only the basic requirement for the objector to come up with a reasonable suspicion. But then you can imagine that if some electors disappear from the register, then the objector may stand to gain from it. Mr. Chen, well, as we have said, we would like to keep the elections fair and we want to strike a balance. For us to publish the provisional register so that the public can check the registration particulars is one of the ways to maintain the integrity of the elections and to maintain the credibility of the registers. Now, if we start to introduce penalties to the mechanism, I'm afraid this may not be conducive to the achievement of a balance. On the other hand, if we can revise our laws and spell out clearly the requirements of the objectors and empower the REO to deal with frivolous or vexatious complaints, then we believe that the system will be less susceptible to abuse and to a great extent. So we believe that our current proposals are good enough to achieve our target. Mr. Chairman, I don't think I can agree with the Undersecretary. I hope this Undersecretary will go back to carry out some research and please also look at the trend. If somebody is to abuse the mechanism and come up with numerous complaints without sufficient grounds, this is already a case of abuse. So please tell us, if we continue to get abuses, what are you going to do? Can you promise that you will act on it if the mechanism is to be abused again? Of course, we will be checking whether the mechanism is working smoothly and will watch out for abusers. If indeed, as Ms. Lee has said, that in the future abuses crop up again, we will certainly take a serious view and we will review the mechanism. Any other questions in the first round? I would like to draw a line owing to the time limit. Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to pick up the point made by Sterry. Currently, the system is such that the objector doesn't have to pay any price for lodging complaints. In the 2015 election, we have got individuals, including candidates, who have lodged a large number of objections, and they have been withdrawn later on. At the district level, during the 2015 VR cycle, an elector told me that he was objected to despite having a genuine address there. Now, for you to ask an elector to take a day off to attend a hearing, now, of course, to you, you think that it is our civic responsibility to be registered. But then for someone who is working, you ask him to take a day off and attend a court hearing just for the sake to keep his registration status, it won't be easy for the grassroots. Now, this citizen didn't attend the hearing and his status was removed. Now, you don't have to pay anything to lodge an objection, and there are potential candidates have done so, and electors have lost their eligibility. Now, Mr. Edward Yu has said that the REO should be taking up the onus of proof. Now, the REO is there to prepare the register. Now, if you ask the REO to have the onus of proof, well, the REO must think that the register is correct and so it has been published. It's the objector that doesn't agree, so it's up to the objector to prove. The REO won't be publishing a register which it knows full well that is not accurate. So as to who should abuse the evidence, I think it is clear which party should do so. It is beyond argument. Ms. Lee asked a question. Mr. Chen said that we need to strike a balance and therefore we haven't provided for penalties. I think this is a loophole. I can assure you that there will be people objecting to the electors' status. Now, at district level elections, you know that for a particular building, there are more people in support of a particular candidate, then you try to raise many objections, and then you can influence the electoral result. So can we tolerate such unfair instances, and which have also caused so much nuisance to electors, to last for another election cycle or even two more? Well, that wraps up the first round of questions. Two would like to ask questions. Priscilla Leung and then Claudia Mo. Any more members? If not, I'll draw a line because we have got a second item.
Ms. Claudia Mo. Now, we cannot ask all the people of Hong Kong to be private detectives, but I think the wording you use is problematic because you use the term the burden of proof. Say, if I say you're a thief, then I'm really required to provide the evidence. But that is different from election. Now, in this building, there are 12 floors, and then the address is the 13th floor. That's obvious. I don't need to give evidence at all. You know that. So if you are going to change it, then you should use the term with reasonable doubt. This is one obvious example. Say, in a flat, there are 13 households. No matter how many subdivided units are there, it's difficult to have 13 households in one flat. Now, you ask for adequate evidence. What do you mean by adequate? Is it your definition or my definition? So can you use reasonable doubt? And second point is that, generally speaking, the objector is not required to attend the hearing unless the revising officer is of the view that the revising officer doesn't want to strike out the case without going through the hearing, and therefore the objector is required to attend the hearing. Whether it is a criminal offense or civil offense, that is still the burden of proof. And legally speaking, the burden of proof has specific meaning. Now please, do not use the term the burden of proof. You just want to provide adequate proof. Chairman, in drawing up the specific provisions to amend the law, we will work with our colleagues to clearly reflect our proposal specifically in the law. The burden of proof, let me reiterate, is that we want to put in the law that the objector has the duty to provide adequate information and grounds to substantiate his or her case. All right, we conclude our discussion of this item and we move on to the next item, which is a 2017 VR campaign. Would the Undersecretary introduce the paper, please? Thank you, Chairman. The 2017 VR campaign is expected to start in early March this year. The REO, through various media, promote the message of voter registration by encouraging eligible persons to register as voters, and voters are required to fulfill their civic duties to provide adequate information and update their registered information. The REO in the registration cycle will continue to conduct the checking and inquiries and matching so as to ensure the integrity of the register. I'll ask the Chief Electoral Officer to provide the details on the promotional measures in the 2017 VR campaign. The 2017 VR campaign will start in early March, and through various channels, all eligible persons are encouraged to register as voters. They are asked to provide true information, and that is very important, and voters are required or are encouraged to update that information in a timely manner. We also continue to promote the online system, encouraging the public to check the details in the internet. In respect of the recommendations of the consultation report, we will update the registration form and will also provide suitable promotion to encourage the use of electronic media, and also the second functional constituency. People are encouraged to use electronic media to receive information. Before the 2nd of May, voters should respond to the inquiry letters so that they will not lose their voter status. As for paragraph 9 and 10, we will have the following publicity measures, broadcasting of an announcement in public interest. Placing advertisement in newspapers, popular websites, and mobile applications to encourage new registration and timely updating of registered particulars by electors. Display posters in universities, tertiary institutions, secondary schools to appeal to students. Appeal to people to register voters, say through the voter through various government offices. Issue letters to new housing estates reminding voters to update their address. We've earmarked $6 million for the voter registration campaign through various channels. We hope to attract more eligible persons to register the voters as voters. We also urge voters to pay attention to updating the information that is very important. The accuracy of the registrar is very important. Of the register is very important. I'm happy to take questions. 4 minutes for questions and answers for each member. Mr. Chen Qichun, I have two sets of questions. Number one, has the administration has assessed the use of resources and also the outcome of the campaign? Have you assessed whether it's satisfactory or not? In 2016, after your VR campaign, what do you think about the outcome? I will have similar questions at the Finance Committee meeting to compare the election years and non-election years and the cost effectiveness. As for the registration of young voters, I'm not happy with the outcome. Among the young voters, they account for the smallest proportion. Those between 18 to 35, 0.9 odd million voters, less than 23.9%. As for those below 20, those first registered as voters, in comparison with 2012, there was a decline of 14% or 20,000 voters. Last time, I reminded the administration to adopt various means to conduct the registration campaign. The administration should not adhere to old practices. Say, for example, your registration stalls in the streets. Are they contracted out by the organizations, contracted out to the organizations by the home or the HAD? I think you should get the universities to do the voter registration campaign. As for registration through the internet, it's not user friendly. Now you have an e-cert, then you can complete the registration through the internet. Otherwise, you can't do so. You just fill in everything, and then you print it out, you sign, and then you scan and upload an email and fax to the REO. But can you have an app so that people can sign directly? Last time, the NGOs had certain apps. You can sign, you can fill in the form, you can sign the name, sign your name, and then they turn the form into a fax and then send it to the REO. I know that ESET is for verification, but as for the NGOs, as for the people, they sign on their phone, and then they fax, and then the app automatically fax the form to the signed form to the REO. Will you accept it? Will you consider this? Let me speak on the effectiveness of the VR campaign last year, and then the officer will respond in terms of the app. Voters' registration is a regular exercise every year, and we'll continue to do our job. In 2016's register, there were 3.78 million voters for the GCs, more than 80%, a historic high. I want to know the increase in 2016. In 2016, in the cycle, we dealt with 170,000 new registrations and 250,000 updates. As for the specific operations, Mr. Wong will respond. Please be precise. Just now, Mr. Chen referred to two things. We are asked to consider them. First, work through the student organizations to do voter registration. Second, enhancement of internet registration. At present, these things aren't present. In the coming VR campaign, we'll look into the possibility of doing these. Ms. Claudia Mo. Thank you, Chairman. Mr. Chen referred to ESET. Do you have one? I don't. What is it? Why I don't have this? I really find it rather bad. I hope that I find it a failure on my part. Anyways, I hope that your slogans will not be just old slogans and old style slogans. Now, the older generation politicians have started to make use of Facebook. But now, young people use more Snapchat and Instagrams. And I hope that you do something about it. As for the total expenditure, 6 million. But the government spends hundreds of millions on many things. Why you just spend just a few million? As for the budget, we have made reference to our expenditure in promoting voters' registration in non-election year. 2017 is a non-election year. In comparison with 2014 and 2013, where there was no election, there was already an increase. As for the use of new media or new platforms, can we spend more on this? I will look into that with my colleagues, see if more can be done. All right. Any follow-up? No. Anyone who would like to have the first round? If not, then any second round, then? If not, then? All right. We conclude our discussion of this item. May I thank the Bureau and also the election officers. AOB, at the next regular meeting is the 20th of March at 2:30 p.m. Any AOB? If not, then meeting adjourned.